So I see a lot of you wake up early to be here. So you are probably all interested into blockchains, because the next talk will explain us how it will work, or how it is, and why we do this. Jelle Herold is active in a lot of areas. He's in arts, into math and physics, and also computer science. And yes, he shows us why we need blockchain, what we use it for, and how they work. Jelle Herold.
Right. Can you hear me? Yes. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you everybody for coming so early. If all else fails, there's stickers on the floor. I know stickers are probably more valuable than the only other more valuable thing than coins. So they're here on the floor. I'm going to try to give an idea why blockchains are relevant and why hackers should look at it. And why they are relevant to the world. Maybe explain a little bit how they work. There's a lot of talk about these things. I went to PubQuiz yesterday, so maybe this might not be the best organized talk, but that was a lot of fun. I'll leave some time for questions, so please ask questions. Let's hope this goes well. So a little bit about me. You can find me on Twitter. That's enough about me. This talk is titled Blockchains for a Better World. So better, I mean, you're thinking money is evil, banks, criminals use Bitcoin, all these things. Oh, why is my slide not going further? Yes, so poop, you say? Right, so this is process optimizing our planet. This is why I think blockchains are so useful. If we apply process optimization to a lot of the things that are happening on our planet, we might be able to fix a lot of the big problems by targeting our efforts at the right places. It would be really nice if it goes a little bit more. So before we start, how many people know what a blockchain is? Okay, that's good. So how many people know what smart contracts are? Okay, great. So for the rest of you that don't know, let me just give you a slight overview. The thing, we started with peer-to-peer networks with BitTorrent. From BitTorrent, effectively came Bitcoin. I'll show you kind of how this works. It's not a lot of extra ingredients that you need to add to BitTorrent to actually reach to Bitcoin, but it took a while. From Ethereum, from Bitcoin, people realize you can generalize this Bitcoin to Ethereum. So that's where Bitcoin is just a simple transaction from me to another person. Ethereum extends this to having kind of code running on your peer-to-peer network and sending transactions to the code and have the code do something. So this is more general than just a transaction. And then the final step is this project I'm working on, where we try to take all the ideas from modern programming language design and to build sort of a process engine instead of just a Turing machine on a blockchain, which Ethereum kind of is. So this is a little bit of an outline of the talk. I'll give some cryptography fundamentals, just very hand-wavy. Then I'll explain try to point out how you build what is called distributed ledger technology. So that's the, you know, Bitcoin and blockchain are these buzzwords, and the new word for it is distributed ledger technology. It's kind of a better word for it. Then I'll explain a little bit about my language and how this applies to the blockchain, and then have some final words about how you can apply this to planetary scale. I will put them online, yeah, for sure. And if so the stickers over here, they have an address on there, and there you can enter your email address and you can talk to me and things like that. Yeah, no problem. So you asked if the slides are online. So the fundamentals. Well, probably the most fundamental thing is hashing, hash functions. Then another very important thing are distributed hash tables. which is DHT and not DTH, but okay. Asymmetric cryptography is another important thing, and here I'll just show talk about signing and verifying signatures. Click. So hashing is this, it's a principle where you take some data and you compress it to smaller data. So you can have any kind of arbitrary length bit string, and then you turn it into a fixed length bit string. So here I demonstrate it's like 160 bits. And you have this notion of cryptographic hashing, where it means that there's a very small probability of two pieces of data going to the same address space. Of course, a function that just sends all the data to the number one is a hashing function, because it takes a lot of data and it always goes to a small number. But two pieces of data go to a to the same number. The other thing about making hashing cryptographically secure is that if you want to, if you want to go the other way, can I put? Yeah, let me. Sorry, second. Let me just plug in power. I see. Apologies about that. Da-da-da-da-da. Sorry. Yeah. Okay, it's better. I made. So, I mean, I go from data to the address. To make this secure, you shouldn't be able to go back easily. So if I have my address to compute the data that came from this, that goes to the same thing, that this is not efficiently computable, that makes a hash function secure. So yeah, to put this, to sum up these properties, like every bit string leads to a unique address because it's such a big space. 2 to the 160 is a lot of numbers. So every bit string, you know, your movie, your Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, goes to the same to a different address as your MP3 file. It kind of distributes evenly over the entire address space, and it works as a checksum, meaning that once you have your data, if you somehow got it back from the network, I'll talk a little bit about that, you can check again, you compute your hash function, and you will see that it's the same, you get the same number for the same data. And there's more tricks you can do with hashing, which is the proof of work, which is the mining in Bitcoin. I hope this was a little bit clear. To who was this very clear? One person? Two? Three? Oh shit. More? I see more hands. Yeah, I mean, a different way to look at this is that imagine you have all the data in the world, all these files on all your computers, and you want to sort of make this address space where you can find every data back. You need one function that takes your data to its address, and another function to find it from the address to find it back. So imagine we build a network of computers, and we want to pull the data out. To put it out, you use this distributed hash table thing to give the data an address, to give every file an address, you use the hashing. Maybe this makes it a little bit clearer. So if you want to learn more about distributed hash tables, I can highly recommend the Kademlia paper. It's a pretty, hopefully, clear paper about how you can find stuff back in a peer-to-peer network. So it's on a, it uses this, for those that know, I mean, if you don't know this, then you should just phase out for a minute. But it uses XOR, so binary XOR, as a metric space. And that means that if you go directly from X to Z, this should be shorter than going from X to Y to Z. So this, like, this space is probably a metric space. I can walk here, everything has a distance. And now your files get a distance. And it uses this thing to find your data back. So if those black dots are the nodes in the network, the XOR metric gives you a way to, from every node, go to the nearest other node or the nearest other file. And this way, they show that this converges, so that after a number of steps, I always reach this file. So to who is this clear? More people. Okay, that's hopeful. So just to repeat this for a second, because it's kind of fundamental. We have this address space, and with the DHT, we kind of make it into a normal space where you can walk around, like a space like this. And without a metric, without a notion of distance, you cannot do that. So that's what the DHT does. Okay, this is interesting. My click here is very laggy. Now we're going to go to the next topic, which is asymmetric cryptography. Asymmetric deals to this points at the fact that you have two keys instead of one. So you have a secret key, and from it you get a public key. Obviously, the secret key you should keep a secret. The public key you publicize, should make public. It uses elliptic curves. Obviously, not going to talk about this. Sorry about this. My clicker is very. So this is the same thing where you have two functions. One thing is to sign data, and the other thing is to verify that the data came from the signature. So for the signing, you use your secret key. So I keep the secret key in my pocket, and I add a signature to the data, and I say, listen, I signed this data. It came from me. And then with the corresponding public key, you can verify that the data came actually from me. Who is this clear? Yes. All right, a lot of hands. Great. Now, something interesting is happening here, because your identity is actually your private key. So if you're a participant in this peer-to-peer network, your private key, which is just a very, very large random number, effective, sort of. And in the Bitcoin situation, this becomes your wallet. So this is why these things are important in this peer-to-peer network. It's an open network. Anybody can participate as long as you can generate a very large random number. You get an identity in the network, and then you can use this number to sign transactions or, you know, files as coming from you. So I'm just going to talk about something very shortly, which is this notion of a brain wallet. So if your identity is just a random number, this is a very nice thing, right? So it is super inclusive. A bank cannot say, sorry, I cannot add you to our banking network because of something. Maybe you have only one leg, and then this, you know, everybody who has a bank account needs two legs. So sorry, you're not allowed to have a bank account. With Bitcoin, it's completely inclusive. As long as you can generate this number, you can get there. And now you can turn the number into a sequence of words. Which, collapse, practice, feed, shame, open, despair, creep, growth. This is called a brain wallet. By just memorizing these words, you can buy any phone, enter the words, and your Bitcoin identity or whatever identity returns. So this is kind of a crazy but a very cool idea. And I actually used this in practice when I went to the US, and somehow my bank accounts got blocked, and I had no internet, but I could export the brain wallet from my phone and move it into somebody else's phone. So this is a very, very powerful idea that you obviously don't have with a normal bank. I mean, you can just memorize your bank account. So I think this is very cool. Who else thinks this is very cool? Less people than understood the previous thing. But anyway, I think this is insane. Anyway, so these are kind of the fundamentals that go into blockchains, the cryptography fundamentals. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about how you turn this into the so-called distributed ledger technology. So what is a blockchain anyway? It's just a decentralized database. Okay? That's all it is, actually. I mean, a decentralized database, an amazing thing that we didn't have before, but that's what it is. So it's a peer-to-peer network that builds a decentralized database. And the way they do it is using a ledger, so keeping a history of all the transactions. Then there's this thing called a memory pool, which is kind of important to talk about for a second. And there's proof of work, which is the famous mining that you probably all heard about. So let me first talk about the ledger. It's a way to... It stores all the transactions that are happening in the network from the beginning of time. So there's the genesis block. That's when the Bitcoin started, and then every transaction from there is recorded. So this is what it looks like, a blockchain, sort of. So we're using the, I mean, nothing. Why? Oh yeah, I cannot point at this because it's a very bright screen. But over here, you have the hash function. You see the hashing again, a block of transactions. It's just a block of data. And the hash gives it a unique number. And then the next block has starts with a pointer to the hash of the previous block. So this is how it builds a chain. Every block points back to the previous one. And that's why you need the hashing. Is this clear to everybody? It's like a linked list. Ooh, not so many people like this. I'll continue anyway. and hopefully get clear. So there's a bunch of transactions. There's this thing called a nonce, which I will talk about as well. Wait, let me try one thing because somehow, why is this not doing the presenter thing? Okay, well, I have to go like this. So the Bitcoin network, or most of these blockchain networks, they work in the following fashion. You have a transaction. The transaction is put in a memory pool. It's kind of the pending transactions. And then you have the finalized transactions that are written onto the ledger. Now, for transaction, it needs to be valid. In a memory pool, you add some sort of transaction fee to it, and then miners pick transactions from the memory pool and append them to the blockchain. So here we see the asymmetric encryption at work. You have your transaction from this address, right? So the wallet address, to this other address. So these are just the public keys of the wallet, the amount, and then the signature. And then the Bitcoin network verifies that it's a valid signature. In order to make a block, the miners pick from the memory pool. So these are all the pending transactions. That's just a peer-to-peer network like BitTorrent or whatever. And they keep them. The miners keep them in memory. All these transactions, they receive it to see if it's valid. If it's valid, they keep them. And then from this memory pool, they just pick a bunch of transactions. The one with the biggest fees on them, and then put them together into a block. Make sure it points to the previous block, so the latest known valid block in the network. And then they have to do this. They have to add a nonce. So this is a special number. And this is the famous proof of work. So very shortly, I'll just give you an idea how this works. These transactions I cannot make up. I just pick them from the memory pool. The previous one I also cannot make up because that was just a hash of the previous block. The nonce, the miner can pick the nonce. And in fact, it should pick the nonce such that if you hash this entire block, the resulting hash value has to start with a number of zeros. Now, does anybody see why this might be difficult? Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, 8, 9. Oh, more hands going up. Yeah, a lot of people see why this is difficult. For those that don't see that why it's difficult, remember that the cryptographically secure hash functions, they distribute data evenly across this entire address space. So the probability of finding, suppose this would be binary, 0 and 1, the probability of finding the first thing, a 0, is 50% if it's 0 or 1. Probability of finding two of these things is 25%. Three zeros in the beginning is 12.5%. So this gets more and more harder because it's basically just random. It just points at some random thing in a very specific way. So every time you change the nonce, you completely change the hash. It goes to just completely different number. And then to another completely different number every time you keep changing the nonce. And you just need to keep trying this over and over again until you find one with enough zeros. And that's what all these miners are doing. They actually, it's kind of the Bitcoin proof of work algorithm is kind of a stupid algorithm. It can be, it's so-called brute force parallelizable or something like this. Meaning that there's a lot of, you can just build hundreds of copies of the same processor that does this hashing and just do trillions and trillions of hashes at the same time and hope you are the first person that finds the valid nonce. And once you find this valid nonce, you announce the block back to the network. Everybody sees, you know, the checking is easy. Just compute the hash of this entire block and you see, oh yeah, right, that's a hash and it has a number of zeros, so that's a valid valid block. And that's what all the miners are doing. They build specialized hardware to just keep going over those numbers. To who is this clear? Yes, a lot of people, great. If it's not, by the way, just ask me questions afterwards. So this is roughly how these blockchains work. It's just a way to build up a history that everybody agrees on. So it's like consensus algorithm, and then from the history, you can reconstruct a database saying this address has so many bitcoins, this address has so many bitcoins. So you might wonder, where do bitcoins come from? Well, built into the algorithm, once you find a block, that's why all the miners spend so much money and electricity on finding these blocks, you get some Bitcoin. So, you know, if you're the first one to find this particular hash function, which is basically like a lottery where the number of the stake is how much work you put in, that's why it's called proof of work, then you get Bitcoin. So that's where they come from. They're not actually mining Bitcoin, they're mining nonsense, and you know, once you find a valid block, as a consequence, you get some Bitcoin. So if everybody's wondering where Bitcoin came from, that's where they come from. It's just built into the algorithm. Yeah, do I want to say something else about this? Let's just continue. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about this programming language that I've been working on for a very long time. This was something that was started a long time ago. Actually, it was Ray Dassen that was the first one to come up with this idea. He's an old Debian project lead. Some of you might know him. He's sadly no longer alive. But he was the first one to say, like, maybe we can use this thing called PetriNets to make reconfigurable software. So now I'm just going to go from a very different angle now for a little while. So I'm going to take modern ideas from programming languages and try to apply them to blockchains in the end. So this Statebox thing is it's a visual language for talking about protocols. It's kind of like a programming language, except you cannot write every program in it. It's not like Python. It's a particular restricted programming language. And why we do that is because we want to have well-defined behavior. And we also want to have portability, meaning that it can target different blockchains or different systems. It can just run on your computer as well, so not in a distributed fashion. And I mean, we were building this before there were blockchains, but it turns out this is a very good, very useful language for so-called smart contracts. Oh yeah, now I remember what I wanted to say about this. So I've showed you a very simple transaction that just sent money from one address to another address. Ethereum generalizes this. So this Ethereum system realized that I can actually, instead of just having a database that says this person has this much money, I can also have a database that stores programs. And whenever I send a transaction to this program address, so it's just like almost like the compiled C code or whatever you program in, like machine code, they store machine code in one of these nodes. You send a transaction there and the machine code runs on an Ethereum virtual machine. So instead of just verifying the transaction, they compute some properties and you get a new state of your... It's like every address has a little table in it. So it's like generalized Bitcoin. And so there's a lot of hacks have been happening because this is not the best way to do it. It basically took just the oldest model we have for a computer and put it on a blockchain. So I'm trying to make this slightly better and use this advantage of a blockchain to make a better world, hopefully. Okay, so about this section, I'm just going to talk a little bit about the history, the background, give you a bigger picture. Then we're going to generalize state machines to PetriNets and eventually to the Statebox system. I think I might skip the demo and then give you some other things. So yeah, in 2003, around the time it was conceived, then in around 2008, we were running this on the Java virtual machine and in a cloud. And now in 2017, you can use distributed ledger technologies. And there's this thing called an ICO, initial coin offering. That's something that's happening a lot with Ethereum. So we'll talk. Let me just give you a, for who knows what an ICO is? OK, not so many people. So an ICO is a way to sell. Ethereum was sold as this distributed supercomputer running over the world. Well, actually, it's not really a distributed supercomputer. It's kind of like a very slow mobile phone. And also, they're not running any kind of programs on it. They're basically running ICO contracts on it. So it's more like a distributed ICO machine. And so these contracts are like the rules for an initial public offering, so when you're selling your company. But they, the smart contract executes these rules. So you can send your money to a smart contract. The smart contract collects the money. And this way, you can kind of sell your company in a distributed fashion. So this is very popular and a nice way to get a lot of money for a project. So yeah, the Statebox language itself is based on diagrams that correspond to formulas. So this is work by Penrose. He was one of the first guys to do it, to deal with very complicated mathematical formulas. He tried to come up with these pictures for them. So you can see that this thing with five things is like adding three of those and subtracting one diagram. So that's pretty interesting. You've probably also seen things like this, where you have you want to make audio synthesis, and the way you do it is that you cut up these things into different modules, and then you connect them with wires. This is done for images as well. High-frequency traders use these things. Business process modeling notation is an interesting one, so it's to describe a business process. Turns out that these things are equivalent to PetriNets, which is what I will talk about later. And it also turns out that there's mathematics for these things. So this is one of the key ideas here is composition, how you take smaller parts and you put them together into a bigger thing. You can do this with wires. Just very shortly, this guy is advisor for the Statebox project. He's very cool, David Spivak. The key idea behind this composition is that you have this composition function. So if you give me something with three square holes in it, and you give me three square things, I can put them together and I make one square thing without any holes. So the mathematics for this is called operets. But the question is, what do you put in these holes? So it's really nice that I have some way to combine things, but what do we compose over? And what I want to propose is that we compose over this sort of diagrams that express a process. And that's what this Statebox system tries to do. You need to use a lot of very abstract mathematics, but that's not kind of the point. So what's a process anyway? Well, in computer science, you kind of have this distinction between an algorithm that just runs locally on your computer and a kind of a network protocol, or like the Bitcoin network. So in physics, you have the same idea. This is a Feynman diagram of two particles interacting. You can do the same thing for like a topological version of this. And then you can combine these things together. So this is starting to look like programming. X, Y to Z becomes a function from X to Z. Turns out that these things are all the same. And these PetriNets in the lower corner is this thing that I've spent a lot of time on. And it looks like this is a language to describe processes. So is this everything that Statebox is? Well, no. The stochastic PetriNets just talk about behavior in the large. We need to talk about particular processes at a particular time. So in order to explain this, I'm going to show you what a state machine is, then quickly generalize it to PetriNet. So a short example of a state machine, a traffic light. We want to look at the different states that a traffic light can be in. So it can be red, green, or orange. So we further abstract it away. We remove the casing. We just keep the three lights. And we say we make the name shorter, RGO. But we also need to describe how it can flow from one state to the next. So these are the blue arrows. And these are called transitions. So putting this together and rearranging the things, we have three states, R, G, and O. And we have three transitions from R to G, from G to O, and from O to R. So this is what a state machine is. And the important thing to note here is that the transitions take one state and produce a new state. So a finite state machine is a set of states and transitions. Who knows what this is and for who is it clear? OK, that's good. would be nice if my clicker responds. So if a finite state machine is states and transitions, what if we have two traffic lights? So we have a car and two traffic lights in the red state. If they both go to green and there's two cars, you get a bad situation. So we want to avoid this. This is to say, in smart contracts, we want to avoid having bad situations. So we kind of want to compose these things. We want to compose these two state machines. So can we do this? Well, we can. But then we have to make all put two traffic lights together and put them in there and draw their state space. And then, you know, the first light can go to green or the second light can go to green. We want to avoid this corner where two lights are green or there's a yellow and green. So we go to here, put this other state there, remove that thing. And now we've added two machines together. But this is not the easiest. I mean, we get a lot more states. We need to think a little bit how we do this. Can we do better? Well, we can using this mathematics stuff. And that's what we're going to do first with PetriNets, to generalize these state machines and see how you can actually speak about two states instead of having just one state. So the idea is that we want to allow these so-called hyper edges that split one state to go to two states. One easy way to do it is just to put a box on the wire, and then you can have two angles come out. Now, one thing you should note is that these transitions can be disabled or enabled. So it's enabled once all the states are active. It's disabled if only one state is active, or if not all the states are active. So that means the traffic light cannot go to green unless all the conditions are fulfilled for it to go to green. We use the dots to mark the active state. So if this transition fires, it will move the state to down there. So it gets two states. You can do the same with if you have some tokens already laying around, and then they just move it. You see how this works? I mean, it shouldn't be super hard, but two, is this clear? OK, good. Two, is this unclear? Not so many people. you can ask me afterwards. Can I do this? Let me show you this in action. Maybe that makes it more clear. So this is an example of a PetriNet. Hello? Okay, cannot go bigger. This transaction is purple, so it's enabled. If I fire it, it consumes this token over here, produces two over there. Now these two things become enabled. This one is, I cannot click it. Still cannot click it, but once this action takes place, now I can click it. So that's one example. This is another example. So maybe somebody is producing things over here. You see them piling up in the middle. And now this person can start consuming the work. This could represent work. I mean, it's obviously very abstract, but I hope you can see how this can represent some sort of sequence of actions that are controlled by this diagram. The diagram explains and describes what can happen. So now this guy can produce again. So that there was an example. Does this make it clearer? I hope so. Yeah. So now we're going to redo the traffic lights, but now using PetriNets. So we just start with the same state machine, from red to green to yellow, and they're both in the red state. Then I just add boxes to it. See? So now still state machine, but now it's a PetriNet. So now I'm going to add this death prevention token. It's this token that says that is removed once the light goes to green. So that's how you do this. You just add two arrows, and whenever I transition from red to green, I consume this token. Now, when I go back from orange to red, I just place the token back. And so now I've modeled two traffic lights together, and I can prove that there will never be two green lights. You see how this works? Who sees how this works? All right, lots of people. That's great. I always love seeing that. So one thing you should note is that I can reuse this now. So I can take this, you know, just put the whole traffic light into a box and just pull out the one place that they all share, this death prevention token. And now I can glue them together like this. So that's nice. Now I only have 10 states instead of 3 to the 3, to 36 for the regular finite state machine approach. So this is a much better way to speak about multiple states in a complicated machine where one person needs to do something and then the other one and the other one. So we can show this in action. Should have prepared this. Sorry about this, it's really Firefox. Love how fast it is. I don't know, for some reason this isn't okay. I'll skip the traffic light in action for sake of time. So yeah, I can show you, this will probably work because I did prepare this a little bit. So this is the current state of this Statebox system that I'm building. Here on the left, right now you see the history of this machine on the right. So this is a PetriNet, and whenever I fire a transition, something is added here. So this is very much like the history of a blockchain, and that's kind of where the initial idea came from. It was set up as a ledger, so we just store all the history of all the actions happening in this thing. And now we make an encoding so that you can store these protocols or processes on a blockchain. Instead of storing arbitrary machine code, you just store this specialized network that describes a process. Yeah, there's much more that I can show you right now. There's a lot of things to this. There's a type system. So on the stickers, there's this thing that says typedefs.com. It's a way, like if you know about a database schema or a JSON schema or XML schema. There I use the word XML. I needed something similar but cleaner because we want to put all these all these things together into one coherent mathematical thing so that we can prove properties about it. So for this, we made a very simple type system. And once you have this type system, you can describe things like a person. You say, well, person is a name, an age, and a gender. Gender is a Boolean, age is a number, gender is a string. You put these things together, and because we describe it, and we don't write a program that creates a form and a label and an input box and all these things, we can make a program that takes such a description and produces a form or produces an API. So this, the idea is to describe things and to create stuff out of it. Another thing is logic programming. So we use a different kind of programming for those that know. It's like Prolog or Datalog or Cascalog or Flix. Those kind of languages, they are, again, they are declarative. So you describe what you want to do, and the interpreter figures out what it how to do it. A nice thing is they have guaranteed termination. To program these Petri nets, we want to fold over the history. So that's Petri fold. I also didn't show that. I didn't show how you can compose things together to make bigger networks. So this is the idea that you can reuse a process. So maybe somebody figured out what's the best way to onboard a customer to something. Then you just make this thing. You leave some holes in it. And then you fill in the holes with your own specific process. So that's the composition thing. Because we're just describing stuff, we can make a compiler that takes the description and produces an Ethereum contract, or you know, deploys it to Google Cloud or whatever you want to use, or just IPFS, which is super cool. So why is this better than normal smart contracts such as the Ethereum language? So it's, I already said it, but it's the declarative nature. They say what to do, not how to do it, because if you describe how to do it, you make mistakes. An Ethereum contract kind of works like this. It has this computer memory. It has a script that it follows, and it goes like, well, I'm going to put this red thing over there. Then I'm going to do some stuff over here. Keep remembering that I have the red thing over there. I'm going to put a green thing over there. I'm going to put another number there. Keep remembering it. And then as you go through this sort of play of what's, you know, what is happening, all that stuff, you need to convince yourself that nothing bad is happening, that you're not overriding any state you shouldn't. Here we don't do that. So the complexity is in the compiler. We just describe what we want to declare it. So the another nice property is total programming. So if you have a function that is that works for numbers, you have to make sure that it works for every number, not just the numbers 1 to 10, but every behavior, every path through the function should be exhaustively defined. And this is really nice because a lot of the hacks in Ethereum are happening because this is not done. They're not defining all the behavior, and then you can find this wiggle room and maybe exploit the contract. Another property is this diagrammatic nature. So it's visual. You can see what the contract does. You don't need to, in your head, reverse engineer the machine code and then reenact display in your head. So okay, when I interact with this thing, it's going to place the red thing over there and the green thing over there, and then in the end it's all going to work out. No, you just see the diagram, you see how your thing is going to flow through it. So I'll just skip this. For the people that know about blockchains, this is very highly related to Oracle's state channels. And the main idea here is to not use the Turing machine approach, but to use lambda calculus approach. So this is for the functional programmers. Yeah, I see some hands. Hooray for functional programming. It's the best, right? State channels, very shortly, is a way to do something off the blockchain. So it's between two persons, kind of a play where I sign a certain state, send it to you, you revoke my state, you sign a new state, send it to me, I revoke your state, sign a new state, send it to you. You keep doing this. So this is like a protocol, but you do it not on the blockchain, because a blockchain is like I said, a mobile phone. It's super slow. It's very expensive. State channels are a way to just do it between two people. It also adds some privacy. And then at any point, if somebody violates the protocol, you can go back to the blockchain and say, look, this guy violated the protocol. Oh, of course, first you need to deposit some money on the blockchain, like you put some stake, and then the smart contract will give you the stake back if, you know, the other person was not playing along the rules. And that's how you can kind of enforce these rules off the blockchain using a state channel. So applications for this kind of workflowy technology. Just to give you a short example, I worked for a travel company, and we had this driver application and a hostess application. So after a long while, there's these two states. It's ready for the taxi driver, and it's ready for the hostess. And then if you zoom into the hostess process, so this is just double clicking on the box, she starts her work and either the customer arrives or the driver arrives first. But once they've both arrived, you can say the customer enters the taxi. So this is a nice way to draw a diagram of the of things that need to happen in a certain way. Other applications are payment systems, people that do marketing is kind of a dirty word. I mean, I'm really, truly a sort of crypto anarchist kind of person, and I believe in sort of freedom and all this stuff. But nowadays, it seems you cannot go anywhere without marketing or some sort of customer lifecycle, making, having a nice experience for your customer. Insurances, supply chain transparency is probably the most important one, to show the entire supply chain what is happening, where does your avocado come from, or your chicken eggs, what were your chickens fed with, did it contain any terrible pesticides. On this side, you see some of the main properties, so that analytics become really clear on such a system. You can see at which state the system is, how many people go to one state or the other. You can create automatic UIs from it. I'll just skip this a little bit. We're going to do ICO as well. There's this thing called compositional game theory. For people that know this, it's very, very interesting. It's to build bigger games out of smaller games. This is something we're building into this. Let me just conclude about this section. So we've seen a visual language for speaking about multi-party protocols. I hopefully kind of made a little bit clear that this abstract algebra and the proofs is the way we get the well-defined behavior and the portability. So you're not just using mathematics because it's, you want to be stupid about it, but it's a way to abstract all the unnecessary details. And that gives you new properties, namely that you can build these systems that can stack together and you can move it from one blockchain to another. And then the most powerful effect of this is that if you use a distributed ledger system, you can apply this process modeling on a global scale. So entire supply chain of your mobile phone or your laptop or whatever, it can be modeled out. And it can be done very cheaply, because normally these systems are used. I mean, a lot of people are doing this, big companies like IBM, and they make a ton of money on it. But these are very complicated systems. So that's a conclusion. I hope we can use blockchains to process optimize our planet, find the right spots, target those things first, instead of replacing your light bulb, because it doesn't do much. Better change your mortgage. And that's the Statebox system. And now I think I will take questions, if there are any.
Yes, thank you, Jelle. If you have questions, there were a lot of topics, please line up at the microphones. First question?
Yes, sorry, maybe this is very simplistic. But does it scale? If the model has to contain all of the world in real time online, then it will explode.
Yeah, so scaling is a big topic in blockchains, because right now every node keeps the entire history. But state channels are a way to do this. So you can, not everything needs to happen on the blockchain. I just deposit a lot of money and then I do my stuff off the blockchain. So that's one way, there might be other ways. Like regular sharding. So it does scale. Like sharding. Sharding, it's a way to, this is done on a SHARDING. Sharding. Yeah, it's just saying, again, using hashing and taking maybe the first digit of your hash digest and allocating data to different buckets like this. So instead of every node computing everything, just things that go with hash value 0 go to this node, hash value 1 goes to that node, hash value 2, like that.
Then a question from the other mic.
Yeah, I have a quite technical question. I saw that you can have splits into the behavior.
Yes.
And I presume there are also AND joins.
Yes.
And can you have loops?
Yes, you can have loops as well.
Okay, could the loops be split off again?
Yes.
Okay, can you then tell me what is the semantics for the AND join?
Well, we can talk
they
about...
They all have to arrive before they can continue?
Yeah.
Or one can... But if they can split off, how do you check it?
So I think you mean... So if you turn this upside down, that would be the join.
I will give you an example where I have to draw it, where it's really complicated.
Okay, I would love to see it. I mean,
and so the definition of end join is really a problem. And actually, I would avoid using splits and joins because they are constructs that are so complicated that it's not difficult. It's impossible to define what should be done. So this was a real technical question.
No, it's okay, because actually the looping thing is something we want to avoid as well. So there was an asterisk there that I didn't mention, but I would love to talk about this.
So maybe you should clarify this after the talk when you can draw things.
So I'm also a lawyer.
Yeah.
And one of the things we see in the blockchain and also this are basically a timeline.
Yep.
Like there's a timeline of events that move the process further. Now, in law, there's a number of situations where court intervened, you have to roll back the timeline.
Yes.
Like bankruptcies is a good example, but sometimes also in just normal contract enforcement, where you want to roll back the system to a previous state, even without the help of the parties involved.
Yes.
Like if you go bankrupt, then the bank has to undo all transactions until midnight, whether the people in charge of the account want to or not.
Yeah.
And I've always had a hard time finding out how I would do that in Bitcoin.
Yeah, so you cannot. That's Bitcoin. You sent the money to the wrong address. Poof, it's gone. There are people that did this. I mean, they're not stupid, but this just happens. So the blockchain itself cannot roll back. And I'm glad you asked this question because this was one of the things I tried to address. And the way we do this is by using this composition. So you could imagine that the bigger box with the three holes in it, that will be some sort of legal framework that says, I can unroll, I can go back.
Right.
So I can use a loop that maybe undoes this certain thing that happened. And then you use your, given the legal framework, you fill in specific processes in there. So by putting a layer on top of a blockchain where the blockchain itself just moves forward, but the undoing is just appending.
Is part of the process. But then in order to make that cryptographically secure, you would have to have the private key of the participant in the contract.
No. There would be a private key for the legal jurisdiction. So you're engaged when you engage in the contract, you engage in the composed one that shows that there's like a legal framework underlying it. So this would be a normal contract that only goes forward, and this would be a contract that allows you to go backward. But you know it before you engage in the process. You see, hey, there's a lawyer that can undo my transactions.
Thank you. I'll think about that.
Okay. Good.
Are there more questions? Okay, there's one.
Vinay Gupta introduced the idea of the Internet of Agreements.
Yes, Ethereum.
Do you think that will fly for logistics, for instance? Because
it has
to connect different legal systems. And And the lawyers may not like it, no?
Yeah. It's super interesting what he's doing. I actually met him just 2 weeks ago, and they're also using tiny state machines. So it could be one of the building blocks for a system like this, where you have these Ricardian contracts that avoid having to go to court, but there's an arbitrator. So this is what this Vinay Gupta is doing, is building these like regular legal contracts and some code that are tied together in a contract, and there's an arbitrator that says, you know, if I borrow my spoon to you and you don't give it back, then we don't need to go to court about it, but the arbitrator can figure out who gets the money. And so this is, I think it will fly. I think it's a super interesting project, and they're trying to use the UK system to to make sure it's all going to be based in London, and we'll see what happens with this. But that's maybe the legal tension that these systems bring. They point out that money isn't what we thought it was, and that the legal frameworks need an update. You know, the Dutch government doesn't have proper law for technology like this yet. Some countries are advancing in this, like Singapore or whatever. But yeah, that's probably the most important thing about blockchain, is that it forces you to rethink these notions of law. There you go.
Yes. There don't seem to be more questions, or if you have a question. Okay.
Then, well, thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Jelle Herold, for this talk.
Well, thank you guys for your attention.